Hello, and welcome to everyone who's attending the Engage 2021 conference to this particular session. This is a session on next generation quantum technology. And it's a great pleasure for me to be moderating this session. My name is Naveen Verma. I'm a professor of electrical and computer engineering here at Princeton University. I'm also the director of the Keller Center, which is a center that focuses on enabling innovation and entrepreneurship for students, faculty, and all of our partners throughout the university. I'm not sure that any of that really qualifies me to be moderating a session on quantum technology, but perhaps what does is that I am an enthusiast of these technologies, and I'm also an enthusiast of the kinds of impact that they can have in the real world through really a tight integration of science with new sorts of problems and problem domains. And so to discuss that, it is my great pleasure to welcome in the very distinguished panel that we have to speak on some of those topics. Thank you to all of the panelists for joining with us and being a part of this conversation. It's my pleasure to now introduce each of them. Let me start by introducing Professor Andrew Houck. Andrew is a professor of electrical and computer engineering at Princeton. He's also the director of the Princeton Quantum Institute. His current research focuses on quantum computing and quantum simulation with superconducting circuits. Professor Houck serves as the deputy director of the Co-Design Center for Quantum Advantage, which is a Department of Energy center that's run out of Brookhaven National Laboratory. So welcome to you, Andrew. It's my pleasure to also introduce Professor Nathalie de Leon. Nathalie is an assistant professor of electrical and computer engineering. Her research involves building quantum hardware with color centers in wide bandgap materials, such as nitrogen vacancy centers in diamonds. Her research group is highly interdisciplinary, spanning optics and photonics, surface science and materials engineering, atomic and molecular spectroscopy, nanofabrication, and cryogenics. Nathalie's work has been honored by the Department of Energy, the National Science Foundation, the Sloan Foundation, and the Air Force Office of Scientific Research. Welcome to you, Nathalie. It's also my pleasure to welcome Professor Jeff Thompson. Jeff is an assistant professor of electrical and computer engineering. His research explores methods to gain control over individual atoms for computing, communications, and sensing technology. Jeff's recent honors include the Department of Energy Early Career Award, the Presidential Early Career Award for Scientists and Engineers, the Air Force Office of Scientific Research Young Investigator Award. And so a very warm welcome to you as well, Jeff. And finally, it's my great pleasure to also introduce Professor Ali Yazdani. Ali is the class of 1909 professor of physics at Princeton. He's also the director of the Princeton Center for Complex Materials. Ali studies quantum phenomena in materials, in particular focusing on direct visualization of quantum phenomena using atomic scale tunneling microscopy and spectroscopy. He's a fellow of the American Physical Society, American Association for Advancement of Science, American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and he's a member of the National Academy of Sciences. So thank you very much once again to all of these panelists. I'm sure all of you can see that there's an interdisciplinary range that's covered here, and I hope that you'll all engage in the conversations that we're about to have. Just a reminder to all of the audience members, we do hope that this conversation can be interactive and engaging for all of you. So please do enter questions in the Q&A module within your system. You'll notice that there's a separate module for chat versus Q&A. Please use the Q&A module so that these questions can be streamed into us. And so with that, I would love to start the conversation and ask all of the panelists to unmute themselves. Let me start by maybe taking a very high-level view and very sort of simplistic view on this. Maybe ask you, Andrew, we've heard so much about quantum technologies, and I think that they've intrigued so many of us on many different levels. I'd love to get your sense on really what are quantum technologies, in what ways are these going to play a role in computing systems, and ultimately, in what ways will these intersect with our lives?
Sure, happy to take that question, Naveen. So quantum technologies are the set of technologies that you might be able to develop if you said, instead of being limited by whatever we have available to us right now, what if you were only limited by the laws of physics as we know them? What would you possibly be able to build? And could you do something more than what we've actually been able to do? So it turns out that the answer to that question is yes. There are really weird rules that govern the universe at the microscopic level that are very counterintuitive to what we see on a day-to-day basis. These include the law of superposition, which says that objects can be in more than one state at the same time. These laws that govern measurement, which says that fundamentally measuring a system causes changes. And this weird world of entanglement, where objects can be intrinsically linked despite being distant from each other. If you take these sort of laws and you turn them into technology, you can start to revolutionize computing, sensing, and communications. In computing, we can build computers that can solve problems that are fundamentally impossible to solve on regular computers. In communications, we can actually build communication systems that are provably secure against any attacks, as long as the laws of physics as we know them are true. And in sensing, we can measure things like magnetic fields or inertial navigation units that are much more sensitive than anything that is possible with classical technology. Computing, communication, and sensing actually encompasses the vast majority of technology that we've seen emerging over the last several decades. And so this is truly a revolution that could touch all spheres of technology.
Thanks a lot for that overview. Now give us a sense, Andrew. It seems like there's, as you mentioned, many different directions in which this technology is going to have an impact, from sensing to communication to computing. Is it really the same fundamental technology, or are there really a set of technologies that we're talking about? And if there is, what's kind of tying them together?
So I would say there's a quite a large set of technologies. People are using many different physical platforms to try and realize these things, from superconducting circuits to atoms to color centers to defects in diamond, or to new completely emerging materials that we're only just beginning to understand. All of these are tied together by finding ways to control and harness the world at a quantum level. Normally, when you interact with the world, all of these weird quantum effects essentially have gotten washed away. And so we're trying to find different systems that enable us to sort of control these degrees of freedom that are usually a little subtle and are usually a little hidden from sight, but to actually maintain control over them and use them for technological applications. And that kind of language, that language that we use to discuss these systems and this ultimate goal of building materials that can be controlled without washing away these bizarre quantum effects. That's really what unites us.
This is a very fascinating way of framing this. I think, Andrew, the way that you've described it, you know, this is really about enabling, in some sense, these capabilities, these functions, but really by making contact with sort of the fundamental laws of physics. I'm curious, Jeff, you know, what, from your perspective as an engineer, what kind of new excitement does that generate in terms of the kinds of capabilities that we as engineers can enable, really sort of making that direct connection with fundamental physics in new ways to unlock these capabilities?
I think that what's really, you know, exciting about this sort of emerging field of quantum technologies is that it really creates a lot of, you know, new areas to go and sort of deploy, you know, engineering tricks to try to, it creates new problems to basically try to solve. There's always kind of a current frontier. And I think 20 years ago, quantum computers were pie in the sky, kind of, you know, maybe never gonna happen kind of thing. So at that point, the frontier of the research was really just, can I make a single qubit? Can I control a single qubit? And then can I do two? And then can I do three? And now we have, you know, there's not just one, but several physical systems in which we can do lots of things with many qubits, and that's really exciting. But, you know, we're not done with this challenge, but now the frontier kind of problems are, okay, well, if I actually was gonna have 1,000, how would I control them? Or, you know, now we know that we could really do something impactful if I could improve the coherence time by a factor of 10, so let me really pull out every trick that I have to come up with a way to do that. So it really creates many different fronts to deploy, you know, to work on this as engineers and as physicists.
Thanks a lot for that, Jeff. And so, Jeff, I appreciate the perspective that you're providing as an engineer. Ali, I'd love to ask you as well, you know, from the perspective of a physicist, engaging with engineers in the ways that you have here at Princeton, and I hope we'll talk a lot more about that in this panel, but engaging with the ways that you have with engineers here at Princeton, what has that meant for you and the ways in which you can see your research having sort of broader impacts, implications, and offshoots?
Well, let's see. I guess to the first extent is, you know, as was pointed out, this is a very broad field, but we do have some common language even among the engineers and physicists who work on this problem, which is the language of quantum mechanics, which is, you know, it's as ingrained in our engineers now and that are being trained in this area as well as our physicists. So we do have quite a common way of trying to look at these problems, as was mentioned by Jeff. Now we have platforms that have many kind of qubits that one can ask, you know, how could you use these effectively? And just equally, physicists and engineers are interested from the perspective of, can we make this platform do something interesting? But also, what is this platform even doing? You can kind of look at this platform as an experiment in itself, something we have never built before. So physicists are very interested in this technological frontier of what is being built by engineers as a kind of a new device that has its own life, and for us to understand what it's doing. On the other hand, we are also learning the limitation of what has been created based on the materials that we have used to create the qubits now, for example, in the solid state platforms. And that gives physicists the kind of another pie in the sky kind of goals, is how we can use ideas that have not really come to the forefront right now in terms of qubits, how we can bypass and maybe make things that are really much better. So I think that there is a synergy back and forth between all the different people working in this area for different reasons, different motivations. And, you know, we're all kind of learning about, you know, everybody's coming to this with different kind of expertise. You know, people in the physics department here at Princeton are very interested in kind of new quantum states or new quantum materials, which may become harnessed in a way that hasn't been envisioned only, you know, 10 years ago. And so we look at this as a very multidisciplinary thing, where as soon as something that is becoming a platform for engineers, we could look at it as physicists in completely different ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks a lot for that. I think so what we're getting a sense from all of you is, you know, kind of the ways in which this is really a transformative technology in a range of important functions and capabilities, and enabling a range of important functions and capabilities, and also some of your excitement as engineers working with physicists and physicists working with engineers, really at an intersection where there's a really tight cooperation and convergence. Nathalie, I'd love to get, you know, your perspective now, aside from sort of the motivations that all of you have expressed. Give us a little bit of a sense of where the field is today, perhaps in each of these areas, in sensing, in communication, and in computing. What is possible today? Where are some of the major challenges? How do you see these evolving a little bit?
Yeah, well, I guess maybe first let me say in really broad terms that there are sort of a couple of different frontiers, I think, that are really exciting now that people are actually building technologies and building large scale systems along these different directions. The first is sort of a fundamental science question, which is that I sort of see a lot of this field as being spiritually similar to neuroscience, where, you know, maybe we understand a lot of the individual components, but then when you start to build up a really large complex system, there's clearly some scale at which our understanding completely breaks down, right? And you're trying to find ways to measure and parameterize and understand the system that are fundamentally new compared to, you know, what we've done in the past. And so I think there's a big opportunity along sort of many different disciplines, you know, physicists, engineers, information scientists, people who think about algorithms, people who think about architecture, to really tackle some of these complexity challenges. And then the other is, you know, as Ali said, you have this device that, you know, we are only barely kind of learning how to measure or how to benchmark. And I'll say one of the really exciting things that's happened just in the last 3 or 4 years is that there are a lot of schemes for doing things like error correction in quantum systems, which, you know, in principle, if somebody was just sitting around thinking really hard 20 years ago, they could have just written down a lot of these schemes. But it's sort of a weird activity to try to just develop new things in a total vacuum, right? But it's very different when you're staring down a big complicated system, and it really catalyzes a lot of creativity across all of these different field boundaries. So it's really exciting to see things like exponentially take off in terms of activity in the space. But maybe to more directly answer your question, I think in sensing, you know, it's already true that people are technologically deploying quantum sensors in current technologies. For example, in my corner of the world, people are using NV centers for GPS denied navigation. So you can use them to do very sensitive magnetometry and use that to correct, you know, long-term drifts and gyroscopes so that you can figure out where you are, even if you don't have contact with a GPS satellite. And there are people who are, you know, thinking about very near-term applications of a lot of these sensors. On the computing side, you know, there are many different competing platforms, and it's a really exciting time right now where there is a lot of excitement and large-scale efforts in industry and also startups. And there's this enormous proliferation of activity, you know, from academia to startups to very large industry, where people are now trying to build pretty big processors, you know, things that are tens to like 100 to 200 qubits. And I think even just 5 years ago, a lot of people would have been pretty surprised at the amount of progress that we've had very recently.
Yeah, thanks a lot for that. So in fact, Nathalie, you bring up a really interesting point that what we are seeing and hearing a lot about is really kind of the emergence of a focus on this technology by big companies that are putting in large investments, also the emergence of startups, and then of course, a lot of work which is being done at the university. So maybe Andrew, give us a little bit of a perspective in your view, you know, for each of these three sets of players, how are they contributing together jointly to pushing this field forward? What are each of them doing? What are some of the unique capabilities in each of those cases that really need to come together to make these sorts of technologies fully harnessed?
That's right. I mean, I think what's nice about this is that this evolving ecosystem allows each of those entities to focus on the kinds of things that they do best. So we see large scale efforts at big companies that are really aimed at scaling up existing technologies and trying to see how many qubits, for instance, you could add to a quantum computer. And you see that especially in things like Google and IBM and Amazon, where they're adding many, many qubits together. And it's a person and resource intensive enterprise. Startups have come online to fill niches within the ecosystem. This could evolve in a number of ways. There are some startups that are providing tools necessary for these larger companies to deploy their quantum computers. There's also a number of startups that are pushing physical systems that are not sort of the things that the big companies have latched onto, whether these are cold atoms or electrons floating on liquid helium or sort of famously INQ has now gone public. We've seen sort of a number of different physical platforms that weren't pursued by the biggest companies emerge through startups. We also see in academia the speed and flexibility to tackle sort of longer term problems that are not immediately present in the how do we scale this technology to be a little bit bigger, but you know, fundamentally, can we come up with a qubit that is immune to the kinds of noise that are plaguing current systems? Can we come up with new approaches of error corrections? Can we come up with algorithms that can run more efficiently? Are there qubits that we've entirely missed? Can we develop new materials that have actually interesting quantum properties to create applications we haven't even thought of yet? These kinds of rapid prototype, sort of smaller scale systems that involve very high levels of risk are the things that are perfect in academia. And I think working together, we can use startups to bring new technologies to bear on industry. We can use industrial efforts to scale up existing technologies, and we can sort of figure out how to get past the roadblocks that we know are coming by using the sort of speed and creativity in academia.
Mm-hmm. Thanks a lot. So Andrew, with a little bit of that perspective that you've given us on the ways that each of these contributors can sort of come together, maybe Nathalie, I'd love to get your perspectives on what sorts of structures do we need to set up in academia, in the university, to enable sort of the rich exchange that there's the potential for that Andrew described, to now to actually realize that, including student exchanges, including research, collaborative research projects, including, you know, sort of joint center activities. We'd love to get your thoughts on sort of what are the structures and in particular what's being done here at Princeton to really enable that ecosystem.
Yeah, so I mean, I think we have kind of a nice historical model for how to pursue this kind of, you know, collaborative effort in the semiconductor industry, right? If you look at the modern electrical engineering department as it was sort of conceived through the second half of the 20th century, a lot of that was really in parallel to and shaped by the modern semiconductor industry. And of course, nobody in academia was trying to build processors to compete with Intel, right? But they were looking at what Intel was doing and what these other companies were doing and then trying to do work that informed, you know, future choices, looked ahead to roadblocks and had deep collaborations with these companies, right? So there was a lot of student exchange, discussions, you know, funding agreements, all sorts of things. And so people have come up with very nice mechanisms for being able to catalyze this sort of collaboration. In the quantum space at Princeton, we've been doing a lot of really exciting things. For example, in the context of our National Quantum Initiative Center, the Co-Design Center of Quantum Advantage, one of the major partners, you know, and Princeton has a very large leadership role in this, one of our major partners is IBM. So we just have structurally a way to, you know, sort of constantly interact with people who are involved in building a large scale processor and thinking about sort of systems level architecture at a different, you know, at a different scale from what we're sort of used to thinking about. We have other ties to IBM through sort of innovative education programs. So for example, we have this very, you know, wonderful program, the Quantum Undergraduate Research at IBM and Princeton program, which is summer research. And it's a very unique program where undergrads can come for a summer and spend half of their summer doing, you know, frontier academic research in quantum information science. And then they spend the second half of their summer doing translational research at IBM. So they get to see sort of both halves of, you know, of frontier research in quantum science.
Yeah, thanks for that. So I think, you know, what I'm hearing is that there's these ecosystem players, each of them have a really important contribution to make. And in some sense, there's a really distinct contribution that the universities and in particular that Princeton is making. Ali, I'd love to get your thoughts on, you know, sort of what is the special sauce that enables a place like Princeton to make that unique contribution? Andrew described it as kind of doing, you know, sort of fundamental work, high-risk work, but work which has the potential to really transform some of the challenges that are being faced in either the startup or large companies. What is the special sauce that kind of enables a university, in particular like Princeton, to be able to convene the teams together and able to engage in that hard, very complex work?
Well, I guess I would say the special thing about Princeton is somewhat starting with interest in both engineering and the physics department and chemistry department in this type of problems in quantum space for a long time. People have been working about problems in this frontier area of quantum, quantum things in materials for a long time on this campus. And there is a sort of rich history of people working on that. And that has sort of throughout, I would say, the last few decades, as the focus has shifted in the scientific and industrial community to focus on quantum, we have kind of people working on these type of problems in sort of different generation of faculty members we've had. And with that, we've been able to continuously recruit excellent people, whom some are here on this panel, to campus to be able to create a kind of generation of scientists and engineers who come in at different levels of this evolution of towards quantum technologies. So I think that both our ability to recruit top faculty, and we've had the ability to build teams, so we have this couple of centers on campus, the center led by Andrew, which is our center C2QA, which is very focused on quantum computing, and the center that I run, which is focused on part of it is focused on quantum materials, which is builds teams for different components of the our university's strategic plan in terms of responding in this area. So we have a very broad spectrum of physicists, computer scientists, and engineers that have complementary skills and have a proven sort of like to work together. And I think that this is kind of the special sauce. And I think that, you know, universities, we are not stovepiped by the same sort of things of industry. We can, faculty members can shift, pivot very quickly towards new and emerging ideas. And this is a thing you can do as a, having the freedom of working at the university. And, you know, when you get good support internally and externally, with having teams that work together and willing to be very agile, I think we can make enormous stride in a space that's recruits also excellent students and postdocs to Princeton.
So I think, you know, as you've described it, Ali, it really is clear that the universities structurally are set up in a way that really distinguishes them from the kinds of things that can be done in industry. And you talked about being able to hire generations of faculty members who can, you know, sort of provide some amount of continuity on really hard problems, but where those faculty members also have a level of freedom, which is not necessarily characteristic of industry or startups, level of freedom that allows them to explore wider apertures as these opportunities arise, to make connections all the way across from computer science to physics to engineering and so on. So these are really critical aspects that I think are really distinguishing as you've described them. Maybe Jeff, I'd love to get your perspectives about, so then what happens when you have, you know, kind of these preconditions that the university enables and a place like Princeton has really been proactive in enabling, what is some of the science that emerges? Maybe give us a little bit of a survey of what you view as really exciting opportunities that are emerging across the different areas that are relevant to quantum technologies, certainly here at Princeton, but also curious from your collaborations with other universities, you know, what are the kinds of frontiers that are being sort of sparked, triggered at the universities and then being pushed into the rest of the ecosystem?
Let me answer that in the following way. I think, you know, one of the things that's really, you know, I think unique and certainly exciting about the kind of the quantum research space at Princeton is that we have a lot of people, you know, to quote Ali, of different generations working on this problem who kind of come at it from very different perspectives, but we have a really good community, you know, where through meeting each other in the hallway, but also joint colloquia and things like that, just have a lot of opportunity to interact with each other. And that creates a lot of interaction. You know, it's not exactly, I don't exactly want to say that it's sort of across the stack, but also across different physical platforms. And that, at least speaking for myself, but I think for other people, that has raised the awareness among everybody of, you know, what's actually going on. What are the hard problems? What are the interesting problems? You know, where can I try to contribute? Where can I try to help? So I can give you sort of two examples of that, you know, from the area of my own research, and then this actually, you know, maybe is something that other people could speak to too. But, you know, some of the research that we do in my group, we're interested in manipulating individual atomic defects inside solid-state crystals, and so we've had a really fantastic collaboration with Nathalie de Leon in electrical engineering, who has a lot of experience in material systems, but also with Bob Kava, a professor in the chemistry department, who has many, many years of expertise in all kinds of materials, including quantum materials, you know, that he works with Ali and other people on. And so I think in many universes, you know, there might not have been a way to make sort of contact with somebody like Bob Kava to bring his expertise to bear on this problem, but we have been able to do that because of this environment we have at Princeton, and it's been very productive. Another thing from my own research is, so my lab is across the hall from Andrew Houck's lab, and the stuff we do in my lab is all based on making qubits out of atoms. In Andrew's lab, they make qubits out of superconducting circuits, you know, where they control them with microwaves. We do things with lasers, but we had some kind of half-baked idea about how to actually do basically very fancy high fidelity quantum gates by putting atoms inside microwave circuits. And I think I might not have known how to start thinking about this, but by going across the hall, talking to Andrew and his students, I was able to basically immediately apply, you know, kind of cutting edge understanding that they have of how to build and design and control microwave circuits and apply that, you know, to our research. And that's, you know, given us a huge jump there.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's really great to hear about what you described initially as a half-baked idea, really coming to some sort of a fruition, you know, even if it's just, you know, across the hall between two labs. But then maybe, Andrew, I'd love to hear your perspectives on, you know, how this then goes beyond, you know, sort of across the halls, beyond the building, beyond the campus, and starts to really get transferred to some of these other ecosystem players. What are some of the ways concretely that the research that's being done in the ways that Jeff described here at Princeton is making its way to some of these big industrial players, for example, at IBM and at Google and so on, who clearly, you know, are seeking collaborations with especially the teams here at Princeton, but also with academia more broadly? What are some of the ways that that's actually concretely happening?
Sure, I can answer that. So I would say probably our number one export to all of these companies is people. I think the companies cannot hire trained quantum scientists and engineers fast enough. And we've had an incredible track record of placing our students in real positions at leadership of all of these different companies. And I think that educational mission is front and center for what we do at Princeton. On top of that, though, I think we can tackle specific technical challenges by trying to figure out what companies are actually struggling with or looking ahead as to what they're going to struggle with in 5 years, and then try and find ways to perhaps get around those obstacles. Sometimes those don't work, and we publish papers saying, here's a thing, and it worked okay, but probably this isn't the path forward. Sometimes we find things that are actually a big leap forward compared with what industry has had. And then, you know, we publish on it. Sometimes we patent it. Sometimes we try to license it. But I would say, most importantly, where we can contribute is anticipating challenges that are going to face industry, which we know because our students work at those companies, we hear them present at conferences, all of us have very close contacts at almost all of the companies. I don't think there's a company in the quantum ecosystem that someone here on campus doesn't know very well. And so we can rely on those contacts to figure out really what are the challenges that they're struggling with or think they're going to struggle with, and finding ways that we might be able to address them on campus if we have good and creative ideas.
Mm-hmm. I'm also curious about how we're engaging with the startups. So the startups we've heard, you know, kind of take, play a whole other role, a different kind of role than the big industrial players. What's happening here in terms of supporting or fostering activities with some of the startups? And maybe I'll direct this to the entire panel and see if somebody is willing to take it. Okay, without that, someone being willing to take it, maybe Andrew, as the last person who spoke, is the default choice that the question goes to.
Yeah, I mean, I would say we are, you know, we are working with startups in a number of different ways. I know that there's a startup that has come out of Princeton recently in the quantum space, AeroQ, which focuses on electrons on helium-based quantum computing. Many of us have done some sort of advising for companies that are emerging or have collaborative research grants with different companies, large tech companies and small tech companies, to tackle particular places where they are struggling and need new ideas, or simply don't have the internal bandwidth to experiment because building these very large scaled systems is often just immensely resource intensive, and they can't let that core mission slip. And so I think there's a number of ways that we've been involved, both from spinning out startups from Princeton directly, finding interesting licensable technology or innovations that break through. Nathalie and I have had a now longstanding collaboration where we've advanced the lifetime of quantum information in superconducting systems in a way that's well beyond what was possible with state-of-the-art solutions at the time. And that's something that we filed IP for, or just providing sort of collaborative research projects in conjunction with either startups or a large company.
Maybe a question that I'll ask you, Nathalie, is how are we preparing our students for all of these different directions that they might go to? How are we preparing them in the research that we do at the undergraduate level or the courses that we teach at the undergraduate level? How are we preparing them with the research that they do at the graduate level? How are we really sort of instilling in them or exposing them to all of these different opportunities, which can be extremely rewarding for their own careers, but of course are also critically important for the field?
Yeah, so, the first line of training is obviously just working at the frontier of this, you know, really active new field, and sort of the fact that we have so many people who are doing research at the cutting edge that are solving completely new problems and, you know, defining new fields really is very unique training for our graduate students and postdocs to then go out and start their own groups, become leaders in industry, and, you know, potentially start their own companies. On the educational front, I think Princeton actually has a really strong track record of innovation in quantum education. We have a number of courses that were sort of taught more or less for the first time at Princeton. And then, you know, we've ended up sort of proliferating course notes to a large number of our colleagues at other institutions so that they can learn from kind of the curriculum that we've developed. So, and there's a number of courses at the undergraduate and graduate level that have now been copied at several of other institutions. And I think basically having this very interdisciplinary approach is sort of the new educational frontier. You know, having people who are literate across quantum physics and information science and algorithms is completely new. This was not something that, you know, people who are trained in my generation were very literate in. So I think this is sort of the interesting frontier that we're now exploring and, you know, are excited to develop new curriculum in response to that.
Yeah, sounds like it's really a field that's kind of developing before our eyes at a time where there's such a need for the talent in so many different places and parts of the ecosystem. Maybe, Ali, a question for you. One aspect of the ecosystem that we haven't yet maybe touched on too much, but we've already gotten a sense as a critical player, is government and sort of national institutes, capabilities, funding. What is the role in your view that they are playing, and how are they partnering with universities, and how are universities being proactive in the ways that they're partnering with government to really enrich this ecosystem in distinct ways?
Well, as you may know, this National Quantum Initiative that started a couple of years ago really ignited the interest in many universities, including ours, to get itself aligned to take advantage of the opportunities provided by the interest from the Congress to ignite research in this area for national interest on many different fronts. So there is on many more applied, I would say, part of this field, there is an interest in us being aligned and you know, contributing to the, you know, development of technologies and understanding of how to improve them in the quantum space. Now, I think, but then at the same time, there is often ways in which we in academia would like to be ahead of the curve and be ahead of the, you know, the current group of technologies where we are interested in, but inventing the next generation. And that's where I think, you know, combining the university support together with the government support, which we all get for grants and training our students, is critical actually to take high risks. And I think at Princeton, we are very well aligned with many of these national efforts. But you know, in some high risk areas, I think we tap into foundations funding, we tap into other things which are not government actually to do the most high risk areas of research. Mm-hmm. But, so there is actually decent funding out there, and the Princeton folks are very good, including the center that Andrew runs, especially, which brings in quite a lot of funding for Princeton. But then there are areas where we want to be in very good positioning for the next big thing that comes along. Mm-hmm.
Now, regarding sort of funding and resources, I'm also curious what all of you view as, you know, some of the major threats to this field and its kind of development. We've heard about how, you know, it's really made remarkable progress, even in the last 5 years, I think Nathalie said, you know, things that we couldn't have imagined. What are some of the pitfalls that you see that, you know, as more funding is emerging from big industry towards startups, and even towards academics, what are some of the areas that you think we have to be cautious to ensure that that progress is made in a steady and measured way? Maybe, Jeff, it'd be good to start with your perspectives on that.
Well, I mean, I'm not really an expert in the history of science or technology, but my understanding is that, you know, when people talk about many technologies that are very important and now a very important part of our lives, they talk about the development as kind of being a little bit cyclical, where there's booms and then lulls and booms and lulls. And I don't know that one gets to control these things. I think the way I think about this, though, is that, you know, what you want to be sure is that you're doing something that's kind of foundational and something that's interesting. So there can be a lot of hype, but you can still make sure that the research that you're doing and the training that you're giving people is grounded, you know, in solid fundamentals and actually really, you know, advancing fundamental understanding and capabilities in these systems. And I feel very good that everything that we're doing at Princeton is, you know, is of that sort.
And are there things that we can do at Princeton, Jeff, in your view, that might help regulate or help sort of keep in check you know, some of the hype which could detract from the field? And what are the ways that we're getting involved, perhaps with government, perhaps with industry, to just help keep things on track, at least from our perspectives, or you know, in ways that we can contribute?
Personally, I don't know. I personally don't believe that one is powerful enough to do that. But maybe Andrew, maybe somebody else would like to offer a contrasting view.
Yeah, I mean, let me maybe reframe the question a little bit as, you know, what would the pitfall be? Like, what could Princeton do that would be, that would maybe send us down a path that was very risky in terms of overpromising? And I would say that one thing that sort of contrasts what Princeton is doing now to what a lot of other universities are doing is that most other universities are sort of all in on one platform. You know, they're building their quantum center around, say, a singular technology, and saying like, okay, here's where we're going to invest a lot of our resources, and then, you know, try to build on that. And I think that's sort of an inherently risky strategy, because then, you know, if that technology is, you know, doesn't pan out for particular applications, then it just you know, is not nearly as foundational and interesting in, say, 5 to 10 years. So I think the exciting thing that's happening at Princeton is we have this really diverse ecosystem where there are people who are taking different approaches, operating at different layers of the stack, looking at different physical systems, and even totally different aspects of quantum information. And then that allows us to learn from each other. So then we can make contributions that are, you know, all the way from being, you know, very applied, right? Like, we come up with things that industry can immediately adopt and then say, okay, we're going to steal that now and make our system better, but also all the way down to very fundamental foundational advances in how to think about these systems. And I think, you know, sort of enforcing that we have to make progress on all of these fronts. You don't just stop doing the science because you're working on technology, right, is very important for keeping the field moving forward.
Yeah, it sounds like it's once again that, you know, sort of unique special sauce that the university has, which is the freedom for, you know, all of the faculty researchers, the graduate students, to explore different areas, but also that tight coupling to industry, where, you know, sort of elements of you know, fundamental scientific innovation that do come out can quickly be channeled into the right places where they're needed at the right times. And so it seems like that keeping that fluid has been sort of a key focus of all of you and really the Princeton effort in the quantum space. Maybe as a final thought, I'll ask Andrew to give us a little bit of his sense on kind of where is quantum and the quantum initiative at Princeton heading, and what do you view as some of the really exciting things for us to keep an eye out for?
Right. So, I mean, I would say what's exciting about the quantum initiative on campus is the rate at which we have been growing and working together, right? On campus, you know, 5 years ago, we were a loose collection of faculty scattered a bunch of different among a bunch of different departments, but there was no Princeton Quantum Initiative. Now we have an actual initiative which brings us together, a joint colloquia series. We're looking to launch an industrial affiliates program. We have postdoc and graduate fellowships and are coordinating our teaching. We're looking to hire new people. And I think there's this real sense of momentum and growth where we see the fruits of our collaboration borne out in these really exciting collaborative research projects that wouldn't have been possible working as individuals. And then that sort of furthers us to work together and to build up more. And so I think we are in a point of amazing rapid growth. And I think the things that are going to emerge are going to be absolutely outstanding over the next few years.
Well, with that, it sounds like an extremely exciting time to be involved in quantum technologies at Princeton, even if that's just by keeping oneself informed and engaged in what's happening here on an informational level. I'm sure all of you enjoy talking about your technologies at any given time as much as you have during this past 45 minutes. So I would certainly encourage attendees and others to reach out to any of us, really, to further engage in conversations around quantum technologies and how they're being pursued here at Princeton. With that, I want to very sincerely thank all of the participants on this panel. So thank you to all of you. I want to thank all of the attendees who engaged in and paid attention to all of the excitement that is being generated here. And with that, I'm going to encourage everyone to continue to involve themselves in the Engage 2021 conference. There's sessions coming up that I'm sure are going to provide all sorts of excitement and new perspective and glimpses into the campus and ways in which it's pushing various frontiers for innovation. So with that, thank you once again to all of our panelists, and thank you once again to all of the attendees, and we'll close out this session.